Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning on this slippery, slippery morning. We're glad you're all here, and we thank God again and again.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. We're so glad to have all who God has called and gathered to be with us here today for worship. Before we get started, I want to take a moment to talk about our Thanksgiving Basket Ministry. Our evangelism committee for quite a long time has put together Thanksgiving baskets for local families who could use a little help in the Thanksgiving time. And what we do is we collect a bunch of items and put together Thanksgiving baskets for families. And if you would like to be a part of this mystery, I'm going to pass around these baskets. And if you see... Oh, dear. Oh. Well, it wouldn't be the first time a Viking person nearly fumbled. But anyways, with that, we're going to pass these around. If you'd like to take part, feel free. If you don't, pass it along. And that will be that. And start this way and this way. And also, we'd like to take a moment to welcome any visitors we may have with us for the first time with a greeting card. If you're here with us for the first time, feel free to raise your hand. And I think I see all familiar faces, but if not, we're blessed to have all who are here. We'll begin our service then today in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please kneel as you're able, or remain seated for the confession. Most merciful God, show us the consequences of unrepentance. You, who have been brought to true repentance, are also given true faith. The death of Christ brings you the entire forgiveness of all your sin, and his resurrection is now your new life.
Thanks be to God, through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Please rise. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
And also
let us share the peace with one another.
Please remain standing and join us in singing Creation Sings the Father's Song.
Creation sings the Father's song. He calls the sun to wake the dawn, and from the course of day till evening falls in crimson gray. His fingerprints in flakes of snow, his breath upon this spinning globe. He charts the eagle's flight, commands the newborn baby's cry. Alleluia! Let all creation stand and sing.
Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, no man can withstand the day of your coming. Only by your grace and mercy do we have hope of entering the marriage feast of your Son, who is our Lord Jesus Christ. Keep us ever watchful and ever in faith, until our faith is met with sight in your glorious kingdom. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The first lesson is from Amos, the fifth chapter. Woe to you who desire the day of the Lord. Why would you have the day of the Lord? It is darkness and not light, as if a man fled from a lion and a bear met him, and went into the house and leaned his hand against a wall, and a serpent bit him. Is not the day of the Lord darkness and not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I despise your feast, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them, and the peace offerings of your fatted animals, I will not look at them. Take away from me the noise of your songs to the melody of your harps. I will not listen. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like the ever-flowing stream. The word of the Lord.
Our responsive psalm reading is from Psalm 70. Make haste, O God, to deliver me.
Lord, make haste to help me.
Let them be put to shame and confusion who seek my life.
Let them be turned back and brought to dishonor who delight in my hurt.
Let them turn back because of their shame who say, aha, aha. May those who love your salvation say evermore, God is great.
But I am poor and needy. Hasten to me, O God.
You are my help and my deliverer.
O Lord, do not delay.
Here ends the psalm reading.
The second lesson is 1 Thessalonians. But we do not want to be informed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as those do not have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so Jesus God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord God will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I'd like to invite the children forward for our children's message. Maybe there are not going to be any. That is going to come up. You won't be the only one. Guys can come real close right here. Come up real close. Now, if I were to do this, what would I be doing? I'm kind of protecting you, right? I don't want anything bad to happen to you guys. That's kind of what a shepherd does for his flock, right? Well, you know, last week in Texas, there was something very, very bad that happened, something very scary. There were people that were in church, just like we are right now, and somebody came in, and they had a gun, and they shot a whole bunch of people, and many of them died. That was really, really sad. And a lot of people think, well, That's all for them. Those people are dead and we'll never ever see them again. But that's not right. Because God has those people. He will always keep them, and he is going to give them new life at the last day. Now, it might be a long time until that last day comes, but God keeps his word, and he is going to give those people life. And the loved ones here who are still alive, who are very sad that their friends and loved ones died in this terrible thing, that even though they're very sad, they know that they are going to see their loved ones again because God promised and God keeps his promise. So we pray that God keeps us safe from things here on earth, but we pray even more that he will keep us safe for life in heaven. So let's pray for those people in Texas and for all our loved ones, okay? Can you repeat after me? Dear God, keep us safe here.
Keep us safe here.
Through your power.
Through your power.
But even more.
Even more.
Keep us safe for heaven.
Keep us safe in heaven.
Through your word.
Through your word.
Help us to trust.
Help us to trust.
In your promise always.
In your promise always.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. All right. Thanks for coming up. We stand for the hearing of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 25th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Our Lord Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, 'Here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him.' Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise answered, saying, 'Since there will not be enough for us and for you, go rather to the dealers and buy for yourselves.' And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he answered, 'Truly, I say to you, I do not know you. Watch, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour.'" The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Dear friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus, his Christ. Amen. The foolish took no oil, no extra oil for their lamps. Well, why would they? I mean, the time for the wedding had come. That's why they went. They would scarcely even need their lamps, much less extra oil. I mean, after all, the wedding hall would be filled with light. Lamps and oil would just be an unnecessary burden. It's even possible that these 5 who didn't take extra oil snickered at the other 5 for bringing all that extra baggage. Such fools! What need will they have for extra oil? Of course, as it turned out, the 5 who were so sure of how things were going to be turned out to be the fools. Of course, we can get a lesson in being prepared from the Cub Scouts. This is more than just a lesson in being prepared. Jesus is telling us here about the kingdom of heaven and about an error that might result in our being left out of it. This error that the foolish virgins that excluded them from the kingdom is an error that is repeated in every age and every generation by those who are of the world. And even we who have had the benefit of receiving God's word repeatedly, some of us for decades, still sometimes fall into the same error. It is simply hardwired into us because of our sinful nature. It's our default position. And that error is this: to suppose that God's activity for our benefit is going to happen on our timeline and according to our terms. Our desire for God's activity is that activity to happen now. And it is almost always focused on penultimate things. That is to say, things that are next to last instead of the last things. And the nature of penultimate things is that they are passing. They are not lasting, and they will have to give way to the last things. And it was this exact same error that the congregation in Corinth was making some 1900 or more years ago that led Paul to write to them: if we have hope in Christ for this life only, we should be pitied more than all people. They were focusing on Christ for the penultimate, for this life only. And Paul said, you should be pitied more than anyone else. And here in America, over 1900 years later, the same mistake is made over and over again by those who are mocking the suffering people of Sutherland Springs, Texas, and the many others who have expressed concern and offered prayers. I even saw where one man said they were having the prayers shot right out of them. And while it can be easy to be offended by a comment like that, we really shouldn't find it surprising. Jesus made it very clear that the world's hatred of him would most certainly fall on his followers as well. But we cannot fall to the temptation to take the world's approach to violence by perpetrating equal or greater violence. If we abide, if we remain in Christ's word, as he exhorted us to, we will know the truth that sets us free. And part of that truth is this: vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. We have to keep our hands free of vengeance and trust that no matter what evils befall us, God holds us still and will not let anything or anyone take us from his hand. Now, of course, the world sees this response from us and mocks all the more. When we humbly bear the scorn of the world simply sees us as easy targets because we don't hit back. And it can get very hard indeed to absorb all of that. But we can be strengthened to endure only because we have been grafted into the true vine, Christ Jesus, who has already borne the scorn of the world and endured it all, and has risen in victory and has given us his victory, even if the full reality of that victory cannot yet be seen. Even if we will have to wait for that victory with dimly burning lamps in some very deep hours of darkness. Yes, because of what Christ has done, and because of the faith he has poured into our hearts through his Holy Spirit, we are able to endure the darkness of the world because the oil of faith he provides never runs out. And it will keep the lamp of our hearts aglow in expectation, in confident certainty that he will come and that he will redeem us. Now, as I told the kids, it may be a very long time. In fact, it has already been a very, very long time since Jesus first said, "Be watchful." But the faith he gives does not waver, even if it seems it has been too long. We hope in his return in glory to take with him those who are his, everyone whom the Father has drawn to him, to take them out of the world's darkness and into the glorious and warm and never-fading light of that wedding hall. You know, I absolutely love the scripture that I saw on the t-shirts that some of our youth brought back from the trip that were from the group Feed My Starving Children. It said, "Hope is an anchor for the soul." Now that short passage or that phrase comes from the 6th chapter of the letter to the Hebrews, and the fuller context is this. When God desired to show to the heirs of the promise, even more convincingly, the unchangeable character of his purpose, he guaranteed it with an oath, so that we who have fled to him for refuge might have strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope that is set before us. We have this hope as a sure and steadfast anchor for the soul. Now, what is the purpose of an anchor? It's to keep the boat secure through the storm, right? So that it doesn't go adrift. Well, especially in light of events such as those that occurred at that church in Texas, it's important to remember what Paul wrote to the Romans. He said, "Hope that is seen is not hope." Who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Even if we should fall asleep, even though the lamps burn dimly. You know, those dear people in Texas right now do not see the resurrection. Right now, all they are able to see is darkness and death in the midst of a terrible storm of the soul. But by the grace of God, they hope for what they do not see. And by the faith God has granted, they wait for it with patience. Like wise virgins who have trimmed their lamps and have a bountiful supply of the oil of faith to keep them burning. It's no coincidence that just 6 short verses before that passage from Paul's letter to the Romans, he said this: "I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that is to be revealed to us." Paul's words about hope were written in the midst of terrible suffering and persecution. Not only his own, but that of his brothers and sisters in that congregation in Rome. But that hope held firm while the storm raged. And again, in Paul's own words, "Hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit that has been given to us." My dear friends in Christ, I pray that if possible we may be spared suffering in penultimate things, the kind of suffering our Christian brothers and sisters recently suffered in Texas, or in India, or in Ethiopia, or Syria, or Turkey, and many other places around the world. Yet I even more fervently pray that God will grant us the oil of faith to keep our hearts aglow with trust in his unchangeable purpose to save us from suffering in the ultimate things, so that we will not be shut out of the kingdom. It is not for nothing, after all, that we end each of our worship services here with 4 words that you know by now: "He can be trusted." Amen.
Please stand and join with us.
Together with the saints of all times and all places, we confess the one true faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell.
Please be seated, and let us pray. Heavenly Father, your church is a beacon of light to a dark and dying world. Grant your church zeal in proclaiming the light of Christ to others as the day approaches, that many may be gathered to your kingdom and saved from wrath. Lord, in your mercy, blessed Lord, We pray that you would grant your help to all who are in need, especially those who are sick, that they may receive healing as you will, and that they may be strengthened and comforted in their afflictions. Lord, in your mercy. This weekend, O Lord, we, our country, gives thanks and praise for the veterans who have served our country throughout all generations. Lord, we continue to give thanks and praise for those who defend freedom and the liberties that we have to even gather here today in peace to worship you. Lord, we give thanks and praise for that. We ask, O Lord, that you would give wisdom and strength to our leaders, our president, the generals, and that they, O Lord, may make good decisions that would keep our soldiers safe. But Lord, we also pray for our enemy, both here locally and abroad. We pray that the plans of the wicked one would be stopped, and that ultimately, Lord, that they would turn and repent and come to faith in you. For you are the Prince of Peace, the end to all war and suffering in this world. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, as the end approaches, we continue to need faithful preachers and teachers who will speak to us the word of truth. Grant us pastors, teachers, and other church workers who will not shrink from proclaiming the full counsel of your word, and that your people may be blessed through them. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Lord, grant that we may not mourn and grieve as those who have no hope, but that we may look forward to the resurrection of the dead, the life everlasting that you have prepared for us to receive on the last day, that we this may also be our hope and comfort. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We bring forth our tithes and our offerings.
Yourself in frail humanity.
let us pray. Almighty God, your gracious hand.
Our Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father. You may be seated. Here is the forgiveness of your sins, and with it, life and salvation. Come and receive. Thank you. Please rise. Now may the body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood strengthen you in body and soul, and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen.
Some announcements before you go. First off, if you don't want to go out into the cold yet and warm up with some coffee, you're in luck. We have coffee hour today. Carol Booker, Joyce Schwartz, and Alice Hansen are serving today, so thank you to them for serving today. But feel free to come by between the service and get some coffee, some treats, and some good fellowship. Deer Hunters Worship Service coming this Wednesday at 7 p.m. Come in your camel or whatever you want to wear, your orange or whatever, but we'll be giving thanks to God for the harvest this year and praying God's safety to those who will be hunting here shortly. Also, Boy Scouts will be selling their trees again this year in our church parking lot. Starting the Friday after Thanksgiving, please stop by and see if there's a tree you might like to support our boys and the Boy Scouts. The Brotherhood would like to say thank you for all those who came to the chicken dinner, as well as thank you for all those who donated their time and efforts to make this that night a success. Besides that, please see your parish news for any other upcoming events and announcements. Receive now the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Go in peace to fear God, love God, and trust God.